What is an apostolic word? Well, to put it in one sentence, an apostolic word is a word from God for the church from an apostle. So that would be the very simple way of what is an apostolic word, just like a prophet releases a prophetic word, right? So it's directional, and it's, you know, it's heavily weighed. You know, it's not something like, hey, I woke up and felt this for everybody. It's like, this is a heavy word. Like, it's meant to be like listened to, right? And so how does one have that kind of authority to speak from that kind of place, right? Because I guess anybody could be like, hey, this is an important word and everybody should listen. But I think that, you know, the Bible teaches us and talks about, you know, the governing offices in the church, like in the body of Christ, and the roles that those people play and how authority is established over time through a multitude of witnesses, through the laying on of hands, through the witness of, you know, others, the witness of God, and really through the fruit of someone's ministry. So teaching on apostolic ministry in general would probably be a whole nother podcast. But, you know, to put it simply, Ephesians 4 outlines, you know, the apostolic government of God, you know, and the roles that people have within the church, or really the roles that people are meant to have within the church, which is another, like I said, another whole conversation. But Ephesians 4, 11 through 16, or really 11 through the end of the chapter, would really give a little bit of context to this, but it's another, a whole nother topic.
Yeah, I think that's good. Just to give somebody some kind of foundation. Okay, so there's a word that God has given you based on, you know, this journey that you've had with him, the assignment that is very clear, has been made clear. And you, recently you said, okay, like the church, not the organization, but the body of people right. need to hear this. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I guess my first question is, you had this kind of brewing inside of you probably for more than a minute, right? So how long has God been speaking to you about what you shared?
So probably about a year, would be about 9 months to a year was when God started speaking to me about Babylon and about exiting Babylon. And I think that for those who are maybe newer Christians or those who, you know, have come from a camp, you know, where it's all about like, yes, we're in Babylon, but we're called to seek the welfare of the city. We, you know, because if the city thrives and we thrive, like, right, that kind of that Daniel message, you know, that we're exiles, you know, in Babylon and we're called to exist in that place. And I think one of the things that I found unique about God, specifically speaking to that phrase, right? Because I was hearing that phrase long before I understood what it meant. And I think that's been for me like a key that, okay, this is a big thing that God is talking about right now. And I need to learn from the Holy Spirit. What do you mean when you say this to me? Why do I keep hearing this phrase? What does this mean biblically, right? And, you know, even when I released that word, I gave quite a bit of biblical context, like to the point of probably boring somebody who doesn't like theology, you know, because it's like, this is actually a big deal. This is biblically rooted. This is not just something I made up. And God
to clarify,
is-
And to clarify real quick, the phrase that you kept hearing was what?
Exit Babylon.
Exit Babylon. So the phrase you're getting is exit Babylon. You're like, okay, God, now I need to process that. Holy Spirit, you need to tell me like what the heck is going on with this? Why am I hearing this over and over again? And what is the thing I need to be processing out of that?
Right. And I mean, oftentimes as an apostle, something will have an implication for me personally, but then it will have an application also for the body. You know, so there's some things where you have to also discern is that, are you talking to me about this? Or is this a word that you're wanting me to process and, you know, disseminate into my own self and life? Because as you start to learn about the fivefold ministry or the apostles, the prophets, the pastors, evangelists, the teachers, the person themselves embodies the message, which is, again, another cool thing that you could study. But like, if God hasn't done it in you and through you, he probably won't have you be the one to bring that message, because the integrity of the message itself is kind of embodied in the person and like the life that they lived and how they have personally, you know, submitted to those things with God. So that's another part of that process of understanding, God, what are you saying to us, to me in this? what are you saying for the churches that we lead, and what are you saying to the church with like a capital T?
Yeah.
So that's something that we've had to boil down over time.
Yeah.
So just a little bit of like context to, you know, for those listening, because even the word Babylon, maybe like, what does that even mean? Why are you using that phrase? Why would God use that word? You know? And coming from more theological background, you know, when the Bible talks about Babylon, or when we hear the phrase Babylon, you know, it's always in essence, a symbol of the world's systems and the world's ways, you know, in opposition to the kingdom of God. And so Babylon is the place that you are exiled to, right? Whereas the kingdom of God, the place where God resides, which biblically, you know, would be Israel, you know, when we're looking at the Old Testament and the exiles of Judah and all of this, like in Jerusalem, that's the place where God's presence is, right? So the kingdom of God is the place where God's presence is, but God is wanting us ultimately to live in his kingdom. Whereas sometimes we are exiled and find ourselves within Babylon. And there is a time, you know, like in the book of Daniel, and when God exiled all of Judah to Babylon for 70 years, and he said, be comfortable there, build houses, make gardens, seek the welfare of the city, because in the city's welfare is your welfare, right? So there is a season and a time where as believers and exiles, right? That's when you hear like words like exiles and we're a remnant and things like this. It's because we are exiles in Babylon, but called not to take on the culture of Babylon, right? So we're called to still be in a Babylonian place, but uphold the culture and the things of the kingdom. And so to hear a word like that, exit Babylon, you're like, okay, so then you are calling us not only to maintain the culture and the kingdom of your reality, right? Like, but you're actually telling us it's time to physically get out of elements of the Babylonian system in which we have found ourselves comfortable. And so we've had a garden, we've built a house, we've done these different things within the Babylonian way. And you're telling us that it's time to stop doing it that way. And so that's, I think, what the distinctive was for us. We're like, what practically does this mean? Because to exit Babylon, that means leave the world. You can't physically leave every single system and thing that you're a part of, right? So we had to say, God, what exactly are you saying to us through this word? And so it, you know, it might mean slightly different things for different people at this moment, because also to different degrees, you know, and so I can't speak to how exactly the Holy Spirit would make that sit for someone else, but I can say that he said, you know, three things I want. He said three D's, which I just love, because it's easy to teach. So he was like, I want my people, right? And this includes, you know, parts of this include us personally, right? To work this and massage this into our own life. But then parts of this are for the body. It's for the church. So there's three D's. I want my people to exit depravity. That's the call to holiness, right? That's the call of the otherness of God to leave behind the ways of Babylon. He said, I want my people to exit debt. And that's the calling to leave behind the slavery of Babylon, the system of slavery, which debt is a cycle and a system of slavery that is absolutely demonic. And it keeps us in Babylon's ways and under Babylon's oppression. And so that's a whole nother teaching. We'll touch on it today, but we won't have time to talk about just how oppressive spiritually it is to be enslaved financially. And so the dependence word was specifically about, you know, who has what you need? Do you have any sense of reliance, you know, on self? And I don't mean self-reliance in like a bad way, but I mean self-reliance. We've just, our whole way of life has changed so dramatically since like the age of technology and kind of how we live today. We've become dependent, you know, very naturally on things like Google and on the grocery store and on, you know, all these things we expect to work exactly as, you know, a certain way and to provide for us in a certain way. But unfortunately, you know, many people around the world would never live according to the same levels of comfort and the way that we are dependent on so many things. And I don't think we realize how dependent we are. And so I actually really didn't start thinking about it until God started asking me questions like, do you really know anything outside of what you keep in your phone? Because I think it's important to not be so dependent, because wherever we our dependency is where we will be controlled, right? So this is an interesting word, right? Because I'm not into deep conspiracies. I'm not like thinking but at the same time, there's a level of wisdom in understanding that the government is not God. And the government is not our source for what we need, but we want to position ourselves in a place where we would never be in an emergency having to submit ourselves, right? Outside of our submission to Jesus.